Penny Pillsbury, the director of Brownell Library. Tonight we have with us Annika Ljung-Baruth, who's going to be doing a program called The Incandescent Mind, Virginia Woolf, and our literary foremothers. We are extremely fortunate to have groups, library sponsorships for this program, our programs here for the first Wednesdays. Brownell Library Foundation, the Friends, Citizens Bank, Friends, the Cold War Overton and Wilson PC, Northfield Savings Bank, Unsworth Law, if you know those sponsors, thank them. We are fortunate today, as I said, a lecturer and women's and gender studies and English at UVM, Annika Ljung-Baruth, specializes in 20th century literature and phenomenology, the representation of women in literature and in the media, and feminist theory and philosophy. Current research areas include the fields of oppression of women and the exploitation of nature in Western society and globally. She's the author of numerous articles and has received scholarships from Stockholm University, Bank of Sweden Tercentenary Foundation, and the Swedish American Foundation. And without further ado, we thank Annika for coming to Brownell Library tonight to talk about Virginia Woolf.
Thank you. Welcome. So I'd like to thank the Vermont Department of Libraries and also Lisa Schamberg and Pat Robbins, who are sponsoring this lecture tonight. So this all started when I got a phone call in May. It seems very long ago now. And I was asked to do this lecture. And I was just going to say, no, I don't think I'm going to have time. And then the person I was talking to mentioned that it was on Virginia Woolf. And I said, OK. I can do that. I'd like to do that. And I really am very happy about this opportunity because I normally teach a Women in Literature course at UVM. But this year, I'm not doing that because I'm directing the program for 1 year, the Gender Studies program. And therefore, I got a course release, and that was the course that I sort of had to drop. So this gave me a wonderful opportunity to go back and look at Woolf and the books that I've been spending a lot of time with for the last maybe 10 years when I've been teaching this course. So thank you all. So when I was asked to put together this presentation and when I started to think about how to do that, I realized that it's absolutely impossible for me to do it without writing a paper. So I have a paper. I am not capable of standing here for 50 minutes, and I was asked to talk for 50 minutes, without having something to hold on to, simply because there are so many different ideas that I'm going to try to convey to you of Woolf's, and also passages that I want to refer to. So I'll present my paper, and I'll try to make it as animated as I possibly can. It will include quite a few excerpts from Woolf's writing. Some of them are a little longer than others. I want to do her justice, and I want to really give you a taste of her writing. So even though they're very long, I will start each one with quote and end each one with end quote so that you can actually make sense of it and know where she sort of stops and I start again. Okay. So, I think I have to have some water first. Where does one start when talking about Woolf and her contribution to our understanding of women in literature and women writers? To do her justice, one has to include so many things. Among them, we would find Judith, the imaginary sister of William Shakespeare, that Woolf invents in her famous book, A Room of One's Own, published in 1929. One would also need to include the 19th century poet, Coventry Patmore, and his famous poem, The Angel in the House, that Woolf discusses in her 1931 essay, Professions for Women. Surely, we would not be able to understand anything about women and writing without mentioning the importance of Woolf's notion of the incandescent mind. So carefully described in A Room of One's Own. Even Woolf's ideas about time itself and of being come into play here, because these views are instrumental and crucial to her far-reaching and deeply philosophical understanding of women, writing, and equality. These notions of time and of existence are beautifully illustrated by the character Mrs. Ramsay in Woolf's 1927 novel, To the Lighthouse. In this novel, the female artist Lily Briscoe is of fundamental importance as well, because her inner struggles of being a woman artist perfectly mirrors the ideas about women and writing that Woolf so carefully crafts in A Room of One's Own. As we shall see, when Lily Briscoe is struggling to maintain her inner peace and her vision for painting, she's challenged by the presence of Mr. Ramsay. Mr. Ramsay, as many of you probably know, is Mrs. Ramsay's tyrannical and self-preoccupied husband. She's also challenged by Mr. Ramsay's student, the visiting scholar, Mr. Tansley, the visiting young man who sneers at Lily's painting and maintains that women can't write and women can't paint. As Lily anxiously tries to maintain her inner peace, she becomes a perfect epitome for Woolf's idea of the incandescent mind and how without it, we cannot do anything, least of all channel the creative force within us into a work of art. Lily is also struggling against the destructive power of the looking glass vision, so perfectly executed by her hostess, Mrs. Ramsay, who is indeed admired by everyone. The looking glass vision, also invented and described by Woolf in A Room of One's Own, signifies the mirror image that women for centuries have been trained to provide for men. Simply put, by posing as inferior and subordinate to men, women have served as enlarging mirrors, reflecting men's image at twice its natural size. In A Room of One's Own, Woolf writes, quote, "Women have served all these centuries as looking glasses possessing the magic and delicious power of reflecting the figure of man at twice its natural size. Without that power, probably the earth would still be swamp and jungle. The glories of all of our wars would be unknown. Supermen and fingers of destiny would never have existed. The Tsar and the Kaiser would never have worn crowns or lost them. Whatever may be their use in civilized societies, mirrors are essential to all violent and heroic action. That is why Napoleon and Mussolini both insist so emphatically upon the inferiority of women. For if they were not inferior, they would cease to enlarge. That serves to explain in part the necessity that women so often are to men," Woolf writes. "And it serves to explain how restless they are under her criticism, how impossible it is for her to say to them, this book is bad, this picture is feeble, or whatever it may be, without giving far more pain and rousing far more anger than a man would do who gave the same criticism. For if she begins to tell the truth, the figure in the looking glass shrinks. His fitness for life is diminished. How is he to go on giving judgments, civilizing natives, making laws, writing books, dressing up, and speechifying at banquets unless he can see himself at breakfast and dinner at least twice the size he really is? So, I reflected," this is Woolf still, "crumbling my bread and stirring my coffee and now again looking at the people in the street, the looking glass vision is of supreme importance because it charges the vitality. It stimulates the nervous system. Take it away and a man may die, like the drug fiend deprived of his cocaine. Under the spell of that illusion," I thought, looking out of the window, "half the people on the pavement are striding to work. They put on their hats and coats in the morning under its agreeable rays. They start the day confident, braced, believing themselves desired at Miss Smith's tea party. They say to themselves as they go into the room, I am the superior of half the people here. And it is thus that they speak with that self-confidence, that self-assurance, which have had such profound consequences in public life and led to such curious notes in the margin of the private mind." End quote. The looking glass vision interferes with Lily's ability to be an artist, and indeed, to be a person. And it's not until she has given in to the pressure placed on her by Mrs. Ramsay to conduct this very mirror image that she realizes the price that comes with it, namely the price of honesty, integrity, and wholeness. When at the famous dinner party in the first part of To the Lighthouse, Mrs. Ramsay silently pleads with Lily to give in and just be a little extra nice to that young man, Mr. Tansley, over there, Lily feels Mrs. Ramsay's gratitude, but she also reflects on the prize for her enactment of the looking glass vision. Quote, "Ah," thought Lily Briscoe, as she felt Mrs. Ramsay's gratitude, "but what haven't I paid to get it for you?" She had not been sincere, end quote. Finally, we cannot consider Woolf's contribution to our understanding of women in writing without also considering Clarissa Dalloway in Woolf's famous 1924 novel, Mrs. Dalloway, who finds her vitality as she contemplates her destiny and time, in contrast to the character Septimus Smith, who has fallen victim to the tyrannizing grip of objectivity and the ability of modern man to measure everything, even the beating of his own heart, his own life's rhythms, and its very meaning. Indeed, modernism too must be considered, and the way it started to shape our lives differently, steering us away from romanticism and connection, closer to that most frightening of enemies, separation and war. And it is in this context that finally postmodernism and its whims and capriciousness also will have to be considered in the light of the wisdom and clarity of Woolf's thoughts on women, writing, and existence. Recently, a colleague of mine sent me a link to an article about our new Marsh professor at UVM, the internationally recognized cartoonist and graphic novelist Alison Bechdel. Yay! Especially known for her series Dykes to Watch Out For and her heart-wrenching graphic novel Fun Home. Just like Woolf's writing, Bechdel's works examine the existential aspects of gender, sexuality, and normative behavior in our culture. "Look," my friend wrote to me, "Swedish cinemas are using Bechdel's test about gender equality to rate films." The Bechdel test, by now widely well known, asks three simple questions about any book, film, or play to help analyze the role of women in it. These questions are: 1. Are there at least two female characters in it? 2. Do they talk to each other? And 3. Do they talk to each other about anything other than a man? Now, if the answer is yes to all three questions, and this is often not the case, the book, film, novel, short story, or what have you, passes the test and qualifies as a work that represents women as real people, that is, as subjects and not only as objects, as things that can be moved around and manipulated in and by a patriarchal culture. Interestingly enough, on her own blog, Alison Bechdel responds to the article about the new Swedish movie rating system by pointing to the true source of her clever analysis, Virginia Woolf. Because, as many of us readers of Woolf figured out, Bechdel's test is very similar to the narrative about Chloe and Olivia in Woolf's A Room of One's Own. In her discussion and critique of the fictional author Mary Carmichael's novel Life's Adventure, Woolf concludes that even though Mary's novel is far from perfect or in any way a true work of genius, it does have some redeeming qualities. I should pause to say here that in A Room of One's Own, Virginia Woolf invents a woman whose name is Mary Carmichael, and she also invents a novel that Mary Carmichael has written, and that is the novel Life's Adventures. And then she goes on to critiques that novel that Mary Carmichael has written in her imaginary world. So there is hope for Mary as a writer, according to Woolf, not because she has learned to write with an incandescent mind yet, but because she portrays something new and very rare in a culture governed by patriarchal modes of thinking about women, writing, and sex. In Life's Adventure, there are two female characters who do talk to each other about something other than a man. Chloe and Olivia are not jealous of each other. They do not compare their hair, nails, or even domestic skills. In fact, they are co-workers. They share a laboratory together, and they like each other. This may be revolutionary for women, women writers, and for the way in which women are and will be represented in literature, according to Woolf, as she puts it in A Room of One's Own. Quote, "For if Chloe likes Olivia and Mary Carmichael knows how to express it, she will light a torch in that vast chamber where nobody has yet been. It is all half-lights and profound shadows, like those serpentine caves where one goes with a candle peering up and down, not knowing where one is stepping. And I began to read the book again," this is Woolf, of course, "and read how Chloe watched Olivia put a jar on a shelf and say how it was time to go home to her children. That is a sight that has never been seen since the world began," I exclaimed. "And I watched too very curiously, for I wanted to see how Mary Carmichael set to work to catch those unrecorded gestures, those unsaid or half-said words, which form themselves no more palpably than the shadows of moths on the ceiling when women are alone, unlit by the capricious, uncolored light of the other sex. She will need to hold her breath," I said, reading on, "if she's to do it. For women are so suspicious of any interest that has not some obvious motive behind it, so terribly accustomed to concealment and suppression that they are off at the flicker of an eye turned observingly in their direction. The only way for you to do it," I thought, addressing Mary Carmichael as if she were there, "would be to talk of something else, looking steadily out of the window, and thus note, not with a pencil in a notebook, but in the shortest of shorthand, in words that are hardly syllabled yet, what happens when Olivia, this organism that has been under the shadow of the rock these million years, feels the light fall on it and sees coming her way a piece of strange food, knowledge, adventure, art. And she reaches out for it," I thought, again raising my eyes from the page, "and has to devise some entirely new combination of her resources, so highly developed for other purposes, so as to absorb the new into the old without disturbing the infinitely intricate and elaborate balance of the whole." So we appreciate, of course, Woolf's irony, her superlatives, and her exaggerations. And we also appreciate the deeper and more subtle hints at those particular gender dynamics that may still ring true to us today, evidenced by the currently devised and implemented Bechdel test. Women desire anonymity, Woolf also points out in A Room of One's Own, not because they don't inherently want to be known and seen publicly, but because of the way they perceive public life in patriarchal culture as a risk to their safety. Now, according to Woolf, if Mary lights up this chamber, this unknown room in which women are depicted as relating to each other independently of their relations to men, something unheard of and entirely groundbreaking may happen. Women will be depicted as real, complex, multidimensional characters, and this in turn will demand from the reader a new sense of respect for women's integrity as whole human beings. It is necessary now to turn to Woolf's philosophical ideas and personal writings, where the need for wholeness and unity is also a constant theme. Indeed, Woolf's sense of the almost sacred quality of the unity and the integrity of the whole defines many of the other important themes central to all of her writing. Themes relating to gender, androgyny, connection, peace, war, life, death, love, and time. Woolf's diaries and autobiographical writings reveal that the theme of unity and an awareness of the whole is central to both her awakening as an artist and to some of her more formative childhood experiences. I'm soon going to say a word that I've practiced pronouncing the last 2 days after looking it up. So here it comes. In the posthumously published autobiography, A Sketch of the Past, we learn that as a young child, Woolf experienced the unity of life as a sudden revelation of being. Those of us who have read A Sketch of the Past know that this is the beginning of Woolf's intricate philosophy about being and its opposite, non-being. Big words. For Woolf, non-being is, quote, "the cotton wool of daily life." end quote. It is made up of those parts of life that we are not even conscious of, that we do automatically, almost in a sleepwalking kind of way. Quote, a great part of every day is not lived consciously, end quote, writes Woolf in A Sketch of the Past. I'm going to now give you a little bit of a longer quote about this. Not too long. Woolf writes, one walks, eats, sees things, deals with what has to be done, the broken vacuum cleaner, ordering dinner, writing orders to Mabel, maybe not all of us do that, washing, cooking dinner, bookbinding. When it is a bad day, the proportion of non-being is much larger. The real novelist can somehow convey both sorts of being. Behind the cotton wool of daily life, Woolf senses the presence of reality, of being. This first became apparent to her as a child through unexpected experiences, triggering a strong emotional response, or a shock in a way, revealing the presence of a deeper and more authentic reality than what we find at the surface of life. And so it is when the child Virginia looks at a flower and suddenly has a revelation of the flower as being part of a whole that is larger than we would immediately perceive it to be, that she has a satisfying and rapturous experience of real life and of being. Looking at the flower, Virginia realizes that the flower, the plant, the soil, and the roots are all parts of the whole. Quote, that is the whole, I said. I was looking at a plant with a spread of leaves, and it seemed suddenly plain that the flower itself was a part of the earth, that a ring enclosed what was the flower, and that was the real flower, part earth, part flower. It was a thought that I put away as being likely to be very useful to me later. Woolf writes in A Sketch of the Past that it was this capacity to see the whole as a child that made her a writer. It should be added, for those of you who have read A Sketch of the Past, that she here describes a few experiences that she had. A few of them were very traumatic and shocking to her. And some of them, like seeing the flower, was not traumatic and shocking. It was shocking, but it was a positive experience rather than one of those more negative experiences. But they all had this sort of shock-giving capacity in common. So she goes on to write, and so I go on to suppose that the shock-receiving capacity is what makes me a writer. I hazard the explanation that a shock is at once, in my case, followed by the desire to explain it. It is or will become a revelation of some order. It is a token of some real thing behind appearances, and I make it real by putting it into words. It is only by putting it into words that I make it whole. From this I reach what I might call a philosophy. At any rate, it is a constant idea of mine that behind the cotton wool is hidden a pattern, that we, I mean all human beings, are connected with this, that the whole world is a work of art, that we are parts of the work of art. Hamlet or Beethoven or a Beethoven quartet is the truth about this vast mass that we call the world. But there is no Shakespeare, there is no Beethoven, certainly and emphatically, there is no God. We are the words, we are the music, we are the thing itself, and I see this when I have a shock. End quote. So this is from Woolf's diary published after her death called A Sketch of the Past, and you can find that in a book called Moments of Being. As many of us know, Woolf's childhood was troubled by sexual abuse inflicted on her by two of her half-brothers, and we also know that Woolf suffered her first mental breakdown at the age of 13 after the loss of her mother. We know about Woolf's close relationship to Vanessa, her sister, who most likely was abused with her. And we also know of Woolf's half-sister Laura, who was confined in a mental institution. We are not surprised then by the traumatic nature of some of the experiences described in A Sketch of the Past. But what Woolf describes above in her philosophy of being and non-being transcends the personal, both for her and for her philosophy. In a sense, it also transcends time and space too, as we normally perceive of these aspects so fundamental to our existence and lived experience. In order to understand Woolf's critique of patriarchal society, we also need to understand her critique of the West, of rationalism, and of modernity's perceived ability to divide and compartmentalize existence into a quantifiable, objective, spatiotemporal reality. It is only in moments of being that we truly live for Woolf. It is only in these moments that we break through the walls and partitions created by modern ideals about chronological time, objective space, and even insular and self-possessed identity. Note that in her philosophy, there is no Shakespeare, there is no Beethoven, and instead we, all of us together, are the work of art. And the work of art, that is all of us, is the pattern behind the cotton wool of daily life. When Woolf concludes in A Room of One's Own that women writers must, in order to be successful, write as if they have forgotten that they are women, she does not mean, as some very angry early feminists believed, that women writers should be in denial about their femininity and so forth, but rather that they need to liberate themselves from the confines of self-objectifying awareness brought about by modernity, the confines that would necessarily bring self-consciousness of sex, of identity, and of time and space. The bitterness brought about by the suffrage movement and the heightened sense of identity had done harm, according to Woolf. Between the vote and £500 a year, I would have chosen the latter, she writes, in A Room of One's Own, much to the dismay of her fellow feminists. If women are constantly fighting and struggling, or perceive of themselves as constantly fighting and struggling, they will never have the peace of mind to write. This peace of mind was widely distributed to men of a certain wealth in the world before the end of the 19th century and the emergence of the suffrage movement, according to Woolf. According to her, Shakespeare was endowed with it and felt no need to insert himself and his ego in his writing when he wrote. In contrast to Shakespeare, Woolf points out, men of the early 20th century often felt the need to assert themselves and their egos. They felt threatened by women who asserted their own rights. Throughout the centuries, women, too, had been thwarted by their own anger, anger that had come from dependence and from fear, anger that had clouded their sense of judgment, and even more importantly, their ability to write with an incandescent mind. An incandescent mind for Woolf is a mind completely uncluttered by fear, by resentment, or by anger, or by any deep-seated need to assert itself or its perceived rights. In Woolf's own words, quote, "The mind of an artist, in order to achieve the prodigious effort of freeing whole and entire the work that is in him or her, must be incandescent, like Shakespeare's mind. There must be no obstacle in it, no foreign matter unconsumed. All desire to protest, to preach, to proclaim an injury, to pay off a score, to make the world the witness of some hardship or grievance, was fire out of him and consumed. Therefore, his poetry flows from him free and unimpeded. If ever a human being got his work expressed completely, it was Shakespeare. If ever a mind was incandescent, unimpeded, I thought, it was Shakespeare's mind." End quote. The incandescent mind was not available for Woolf's imagined sister of Shakespeare, Judith. In A Room of One's Own, Woolf imagines that Shakespeare has a sister and that her name is Judith. And then she goes back and she looks at the conditions of women in England in the late 16th century and tries to figure out what her chances would have been in terms of expressing her genius. Judith, who, as we learn in A Room of One's Own, also had the gift of genius. Judith, growing up in the late 16th century, had no means of expressing her genius as the customs of the time did not approve of women's independence. Instead of being encouraged to write like her brother, Judith was in fact betrothed to a much older man, and when she resisted pressure to marry in order to ensure the financial survival of her family. When she escaped to the theaters in London, she was prohibited from acting, since this was not perceived as suitable for any woman. Eventually, she accepted the protection of the acting manager, Nick Green, and found herself, of course, pregnant with his child. Judith, crazed with her gift and her desire to express it, meets her tragic destiny in the gutters of London, where she eventually commits suicide. So what can we do to save Judith, the fictional sister of William Shakespeare, from her tragic fate? Is the vote and £500 a year enough to liberate her from the terrible and oppressive customs of her time and set her free to express her genius through whatever art form she may choose? Well, according to Woolf, in her 1931 speech, Professions for Women, suffrage and financial freedom are not enough, and more remains to be done. The problem persists, Woolf goes on to say in the speech, because of the angel in the house. Referring to Coventry Patmore's poem with that same name, published in 1854, Woolf explains that his version of the ideal woman has been internalized by women much to their demise. So in 1854, Coventry Patmore, the British poet, publishes a poem called The Angel in the House, in which he celebrates his wife as the ideal woman. And she is the ideal woman because she's constantly sacrificing herself for her family and for her children and so forth. Whereas Patmore celebrates the perfection that he sees in his wife, who, through self-sacrifice and constant attention to her family, epitomizes the angel, Woolf presents the angel instead as a threat to all women, and certainly all women who attempt to write. Uninvited, the angel will be sure to sneak up behind any writing woman and take a peek at her words. And should she find anything in the least unflattering about men, or anything unchaste for that matter, she will attempt to steer the writer in a different direction. Imagining a young woman engaged in writing a book review, Woolf hears the angel exclaim, quote, "My dear, you are a young woman. You are writing about a book that has been written by a man. Be sympathetic, be tender, flatter, deceive. Use all the arts and wiles of our sex. Never let anybody guess that you have a mind of your own. Above all, be pure," end quote. For the angel herself is a phantom of the perfect woman. In Woolf's own words, quote, "She was intensely sympathetic, she was immensely charming, she was utterly unselfish, she excelled in the difficult arts of family life, she sacrificed herself daily. If there was a chicken, she took the leg. If there was a draft, she sat in it. In short, she was so constituted that she never had a mind or a wish of her own, but preferred to sympathize always with the minds and wishes of others. Above all, I need not say it, she was pure. Her purity was supposed to be her chief beauty, her blushes, her great grace," end quote. In Professions for Women, we learn that, as an act of self-defense, Woolf decides to kill the angel in the house. I'm going to read you that passage. This is Woolf. "I now record the one act for which I take some credit to myself. Though the credit rightly belongs to some excellent ancestors of mine who left me a certain sum of money, shall we say £500 a year, so that it was not necessary for me to depend solely on charm for my living, I turned upon her and caught her by the throat. I did my best to kill her. My excuse, if I were to be had up in a court of law, would be that I acted in self-defense. Had I not killed her, she would have killed me. She would have plucked the heart out of my writing. For as I found directly I put pen to paper, you cannot review even a novel without having a mind of your own, without expressing what you think to be the truth about human relations, morality, sex. And all these questions, according to the angel of the house, cannot be dealt with freely and openly by women. They must charm, they must conciliate, they must, to put it bluntly, tell lies if they are to succeed." As many of us know, the angel in the house referred to here is strikingly similar to Woolf's own mother, Julia Stevens, the beautiful and much reverenced deceased wife of Sir Leslie Stevens. We may also be aware of the fact that Woolf herself could not put the internalized voice of her own mother to rest until she wrote to the Lighthouse in 1927. In A Sketch of the Past, Woolf writes, quote, "Until I was in the 40s, I could settle the date by seeing when I wrote to the Lighthouse. The presence of my mother obsessed me. I could hear her voice, see her, imagine what she would say or do as I went about my day's doings." End quote. Into the Lighthouse, we become familiar with the wild and wonderful beauty of Woolf's childhood, and with Woolf's attempt in this novel to reconcile the contradicting qualities of her own mother, her neglect and her exemplary motherhood. For instance, her neglect, letting the things that happened to Woolf as she was growing up happen without noticing it, and her exemplary motherhood, her aura as the angel in the house, and her absolutely fascinating sensual beauty that really takes everybody in. Everybody is in love with Mrs. Ramsay. those of you who read the book, everybody, even you, the reader, fall in love with Mrs. Ramsay. It's impossible not to. Into the Lighthouse, Julia Stevens, portrayed as Mrs. Ramsay, becomes a woman of much wisdom who is caught in the net of patriarchy, a much reverenced woman who, although cherishing this reverence, is tragically unaware of its price, the price of self-sacrifice that eventually leads to her untimely death. Into the Lighthouse, Mrs. Ramsay is portrayed as the hub of the wheel and the center of the universe for her husband and her children, the one that holds everything together. Just like Clarissa Dalloway in Woolf's novel, Mrs. Dalloway, Mrs. Ramsay is also the perfect hostess. And in both novels, this occupation, being the perfect hostess, is far removed from the triviality of ladies' magazines and conduct books. Instead, it has existential and deeply philosophical implications. Creating the dinner party for her family, friends, and invited guests becomes an artistic endeavor, an attempt to create unity, and to, for a moment in time, create something that is deeply meaningful and never goes away. It is an attempt to reach deeper, to find something more real and more solid than the evanescent passing of chronological time. Mrs. Ramsay, upon leaving the room after the dinner party is over, looks back over her shoulder and takes immense satisfaction at having created something that will last beyond her lifetime. I'm going to read you a quote from To the Lighthouse, and I'm hoping that you love it as much as I do, because it's fairly long. With her foot on the threshold, she waited a moment longer in a scene which was vanishing even as she looked. And then, as she moved and took Minta's arm and left the room, it changed. It shaped itself differently. It had become, she knew, giving one last look at it over her shoulder, already the past. Not that she did, in fact, run or hurry. She went, indeed, rather slowly. She felt rather inclined just for a moment to stand still after all that chatter and pick out one particular thing, the thing that mattered, to detach it, separate it off, clean it of all the emotions and odds and ends of things, and so hold it before her and bring it to the tribunal where, arranged about in conclave, sat the judges she had set up to decide these things. Is it good? Is it bad? Is it right or wrong? Where are we all going to? And so on. So she righted herself after the shock of the event, and quite unconsciously and incongruously used the branches of the elm trees outside to help her to stabilize her position. Her world was changing. They were still. The event had given her a sense of movement. All must be in order. She must get that right and that right, she thought, insensibly approving of the dignity of the tree stillness, and now again of the superb upward rise, like the beak of a ship up a wave, of the elm branches as the wind raised them. For it was windy, she stood a moment to look out. It was windy so that the leaves now and then brushed open a star, and the stars themselves seemed to be shaking and darting light and trying to flash out between the edges of the leaves. Yes, that was done then, accomplished, and as with all things done, became solemn. Now one thought of it, cleared of chatter and emotion, it seemed always to have been only was shown now, and so being shown struck everything into stability. They would, that is, her guests, they would, she thought, going on again, however long they lived, come back to this night, this moon, this wind, this house, and to her too. It flattered her, where she was most susceptible of flattery, to think how, wound about in their hearts, however long they lived, she would be woven. And this, and this, and this, she thought, going upstairs laughing, but affectionately, at the sofa on the landing, her mother's, at the rocking chair, her father's, at the map of the Hebrides, all that would be revived again in their lives. And she felt with her hand on the nursery door that community of feeling with other people, which emotion gives as if the walls of partition had become so thin that practically the feeling was one of relief and happiness. It was all one stream. And chairs, tables, maps were hers, were theirs. It did not matter whose. And they would carry it on when she was dead. End quote. When the third part of the novel opens and Mrs. Ramsay is dead, we find Lily Briscoe, who has returned at the breakfast table questioning the very value of existence. We find the family in disarray as the much-awaited trip to the lighthouse is finally going to take place 10 years after it was originally planned. In the following pages, the reader will witness a resurrection of meaning, and more importantly, a resurrection of Mrs. Ramsay herself, as she makes an appearance in front of Lily, who is struggling to finish her painting. Lily will find that Mr. Ramsay can be a gracious man, tying and untying her shoestrings in an attempt to connect with her about anything, just about anything that the two of them can talk about. She will discover that she does not have to give up her integrity to please and mollify the old professor. She can simply be herself, have her vision, and finish her painting. And as James and Cam and Mr. Ramsay finally land at the lighthouse, Lily Briscoe is set free, just like Virginia, to have her vision. It is simply impossible to do justice to Woolf's thoughts on women and writing. In this attempt, I have left out so much, such as Mrs. Brown and Mr. Bennett, and many others. How can I include them all? Suffice it to say that we all owe so much to Woolf. When Sandra Gilbert and Susan Gubar write their very famous and influential book, The Anxiety of Authorship, in 1979, it is clear that they, too, are indebted to Woolf. According to Gilbert and Gubar, and this will seem familiar to you now, as because we've just talked about Woolf, women during the 19th century were inhibited in their writing by a fundamental insecurity regarding authorship itself. If women have been taught to be angels, tending to others rather than themselves, and always sacrificing their own opinions in favor of men's, have they not been thoroughly trained to not have a self at all? And if they don't have a self at all, or rather, if their self consists of not having a self, would it not seem contradictory for them, maybe even suicidal, to assert themselves, especially through the means of art? In this sense, as Gilbert and Gubar point out, authorship for women becomes an anomaly, an impossibility that could not be achieved without either destroying the woman or the authorship itself. Pointing forward to postmodernity, Gilbert and Gubar describe a new age for women writers who have made it out of the box so carefully described by authors such as Woolf and Charlotte Perkins Gilman with her The Yellow Wallpaper, an age in which women can be and are embraced and celebrated as individuals and full human beings rather than as sexual beings with predetermined characteristics confining their thinking, being, achievement, and behavior. Woolf herself wanted to look forward to an androgynous age, a period where we were not divided by age, sex, gender, and time, an age in which identity, time, and space are all perceived of as integral and continuous aspects of the human experience. In A Room of One's Own, she imagines the perfect state of the creative mind as androgynous. Her vision of androgyny is exemplified by looking out of her window into London traffic and seeing a man and a woman entering a taxi cab together. And I think I will conclude my presentation here today by reading this passage to you from A Room of One's Own. Again, this also is a fairly long passage. Hopefully you will enjoy it. Woolf is looking out of her window. At this moment, as so often happens in London, there was a complete lull and suspension of traffic. A single leaf detached itself from the tree at the end of the street, and in that pause and suspension fell. Somehow, it was like a signal falling, a signal pointing to a force in things which one had overlooked. It seemed to point to a river which flowed past invisibly around the corner down the street and took people and eddied them along. Now it was bringing from one side of the street to the other diagonally a girl in patent leather boots, and then a young man in a maroon overcoat. It was also bringing a taxi cab, and it brought all three together at a point directly beneath my window, where the taxi stopped and the girl and the young man stopped. And they got into the taxi, and the cab glided off as if it were swept on by the current elsewhere. The sight was ordinary enough. What was strange was the rhythmical order with which my imagination had invested it, and the fact that the ordinary sight of two people getting into a cab had the power to communicate something of their own seeming satisfaction. The sight of two people coming down the street and meeting at the corner seems to ease the mind of some strain, I thought, watching the taxi turn and make off. Perhaps to think, as I had been thinking these 2 days, of one sex as distinct from the other is an effort. It interferes with the unity of the mind. Now that effort had ceased and that unity had been restored by seeing two people come together and get into a taxi cab. What does one mean by the unity of the mind, I pondered. For clearly, the mind has so great a power of concentrating at any point, at any moment, that it seems to have no single state of being. Clearly, the mind is always altering its focus and bringing the world into different perspectives. But some of these states of mind seem, even if adopted spontaneously, to be less comfortable than others. In order to keep oneself continuing in them, one is unconsciously holding something back, and gradually the repression becomes an effort. But there may be some state of mind in which one could continue without effort because there is nothing required to be held back. And this, perhaps, I thought, coming in from the window, is one of them. For certainly, when I saw the couple get into the taxicab, the mind felt as if, after being divided, it had come together again in a natural fusion. The sight of the two people getting into the taxi and the satisfaction it gave me made me also ask whether there are two sexes in the mind corresponding to the two sexes in the body, and whether they also require to be united in order to get complete satisfaction and happiness. Coleridge perhaps meant this when he said that a great mind is androgynous. Perhaps the androgynous mind is less apt to make these distinctions than the single-sexed mind. He meant perhaps that the androgynous mind is resonant and porous, that it transmits emotion without impediment, that it is naturally creative, incandescent, and undivided. Thank you very much. The question is, was if I mentioned Charlotte Perkins Gilman and other authors that also somehow have portrayed what we're talking about here. My reading is very sort of, it jumps around. So I would say that the authors that come to mind, chronologically it jumps around. So the authors that come to mind for me are, Margaret Atwood, for instance. So later writers who perfectly describes this in, for instance, The Handmaid's Tale, Maxine Hong Kingston in The Woman Warrior. I'm sure that there are others, but I would have to just sort of jar my mind a little bit. I'm so into Woolf, I can't think of anybody else. Any other questions? Yes.
How did you think of Jane Austen?
Yeah, if you read A Room of One's Own, you'll see that in, I think it's in chapter 4, that she talks quite a bit about Jane Austen, and she really has a lot of respect for Jane Austen, and she finds that Jane Austen is one of the few writers that can write with what she calls the incandescent mind without that sort of anger troubling her writing. She does not feel the same way about Charlotte Bronte. And so she makes a distinction between the two of them. But Jane Austen, for her, actually, she does. She's up there with Shakespeare.
Does Virginia Woolf consider that she herself has an incandescent mind?
That's a very good question. And, when I teach this class, you get sort of the devil's advocate question where you're like, listen, these books are all about these women who are, in these situations. I think that if you look at her diaries, she always sort of talks about herself in terms of not being able to do that, right? So, for instance, in A Sketch of the Past, when she talks about writing and portraying being and non-being and so forth, she says of herself that she can't do that. So I'd say that she herself had a fairly modest understanding of her own abilities. And then it is up to us, the reader, to judge whether, first of all, we agree with the whole idea about the incandescent mind, which isn't a given. And then secondly, if we do agree, if we feel that Woolf herself can master this. I didn't talk so much about Mrs. Dalloway, but I think that getting to know Septimus Smith and Mrs. Dalloway. And, this whole notion of unity is so central in her writing. It's so important to her, and that is also so central for the incandescent mind. the whole notion of being whole and of being able to express this kind of connection. And with Septimus Smith, the character in Mrs. Dalloway, you know, it mirrors Woolf's own life in that his mental unhealth, right, his struggling with insanity, is very much revolves around him thinking that he can see unity and patterns and, you know, things that sort of convey to him a reality behind the surface of life. So there is also that connection there that is connected to Woolf's struggles with mental instability. Yes, yes, yeah. And what's also interesting, if you read Mrs. Dalloway, is that at certain points, Septimus, you know, if you compare him to the psychologists that are set to take care of him, seems to be one of the saner people around, you know, so that there's a real criticism of modernity and the whole Cartesian notion that we can sort of quantify existence and understand it in that way in Mrs. Dalloway, yeah. Which is, of course, an assault on that unity. Yes?
I was wondering if Virginia Woolf had much experience with Eastern philosophy?
That's a very good question. I think, you know, I'd love to look into that more. I think that she did. And it's definitely a subject I like to explore. I couldn't tell you, you know, right, you know, I seem to remember having read something about it, but it was a while ago. But it definitely comes to mind, yes, when we think about this. Even though I seem to have remembered reading maybe about her pondering that, I can't recall any of her works seriously considering or writing about Eastern philosophy. So I think that she might be influenced, but it's not present, you know, in any overt manner in any of the writing that I have been exposed to. She suffered mental breakdowns, and I think that in retrospect, you know, people are saying things like that she probably was bipolar, maybe. I'm sure if you go in and search on articles related to mental illness and Woolf, you would find, like, 25,000 hits or something like that. A lot of people have looked into that. What is interesting, I think, about her works is, first of all, the sensory overload fits very well in with a certain technique that became so popular, a stream of consciousness, so that, you know, it really could convey that. Also, I think that it's widely known that Woolf would get headaches and she would get migraines, and then finally when they were, you know, when they would go away, she would be able to write, so that it would sort of go in waves. What's interesting about her characterization of Septimus, though, is that she's also portraying his need for unity and wholeness as a very sane kind of need for integrity and connection and so forth. And the reason I included it so much in this paper is that it fits very well with the need that she's portraying for women to be viewed as and described as whole human beings. And so that when you have the angel in the house and that whole dynamic, what really is happening is that you're sort of denying and being dishonest, in a sense, about who you really are. And so it takes away that unity. And so there's a section in A Room of One's Own where Woolf writes about how she walks down, you know, she goes into the Parliament in London, and she's walking down and she sees all the pictures of all the men, and she says if one is a woman, one experiences a sudden splitting off of consciousness, which is, of course, this othering, right? And so what we know today about this othering is really also splitting off and compartmentalization and all these things that she could see were sort of coming with the modernist movement. And so she looks back in A Room of One's Own to the you know, the romantic poets and so forth, and she's obviously not saying everything was great then, but she's looking at the optimism and the hope and the sense of connection and so forth that she could see there. Okay, well, thank you.